Hello dear learners. So today we are going to learn about operating system, which is a part of your third semester course in MCA and MSc.IT syllabus of Krishna Kanta Hendrik State Open University. So today I'll talk about the first chapter, that is introduction to operating system. So I have divided this chapter into three segments. In the first segment, we'll talk about the definition of operating system and its objectives. In the second segment, I'll talk about the operating system services. And in the third, we'll talk about the classification of operating system. So now let us look at the definition of operating system. So operating system can be said to be a software which acts as an interface between the computer user and the computer hardware. Now, all of the operating systems need to fulfill three objectives. So, the first objective is ease of use. So, basically, when we use a computer, we use a lot of devices along with the computer. Now, each of these devices, they have a device driver along with it. Now, this is the job of the operating system to issue commands to this device driver so that we can issue commands to the particular devices. So that is the ease of use. That is, we don't have to give low level instructions to the device, because as an operating system, it gives us the high level commands to the device, which gets translated to low level commands for the devices. Now, the second objective is efficient utilization of resources. So in here, the operating system, it acts as a manager so that it can allot the different resources to the different users or different programs that are asking for those resources. So now let us look at the third objective. So the third objective is ability to evolve. So the operating system needs to keep on evolving. That is, it needs to keep on improving itself by adding more functions and more resources to it. For example, if we consider Windows, we have a number of operating systems that have come up within the years. So we have Windows 7, Windows XP, then we have Windows 10, so on. Every operating system needs to evolve. So that is the third objective of every operating system. Now let us move on to the second segment. So in the second segment, we'll talk about the operating system services. So mainly, the operating system services have been grouped into four categories. So now let us look at the first category, that is program execution and control. Now all the services that are related to the program, for example creation of a program, deletion of a program, allotting resources for that particular program, all the services come under program execution. So allotting space for a program execution is also a service that is done under this group. Now let us look at the second group of operating system services, that is IO operations, or we can say as input output operations. So all the input output instructions, the input that we give to the computer, the output that we get from the computer, so all these operations come under the input output operations. So this takes care of all of that. Suppose we need to print a file, so that instruction will come from this part of the operating system. Next, let us look at the third operating system services, which is file manipulation. We know that all the data that we have in the computer are stored in the form of files. So the creation of these files on the directories, the deletion of the files in the directories, plus opening a file, reading a file. So all these functions are supported by this file manipulation service of the operating system. So now, next let us look at the fourth operating system service, that is error detection. Now let me ask you a question. So if we try to open an MS Word file in a VLC media player, will it open?
No.
Yes. Why no? Because the format won't match. So how will it detect? Now who will detect that we are trying to open a Word file in a media player? So that is the job of this error detection part of the operating system. So here we have four main services for the operating system. So now these four services can be again grouped into something sub-services. So now let us look at those. The first subsystem service is process management system. Now the services that will come under process management system are allocating the memory to a process, creating the process control block, that is it will keep track of where the program starts and where the program ends, the memory that has been allotted to the process. Also, the life cycle of the process. That is, every process has a life cycle, which we'll again learn in the second chapter. So there, this life cycle that is also managed by the process management system. Next, we have another service, that is process scheduling. Now, for example, let us take two processes, P1 and P2. So here I want to tell you, those of you who don't know, a program in execution is said to be a process. Simply that, we have a program, let us say a C program. When we execute it, we simply say that it is now a process. So let us, for example, take two processes, P1 and P2. Now, I have only one CPU and I need to execute both of these programs. Now, who will get the CPU first and who will get it the second? So, who is going to take the decision? So, that decision is going to be taken by the operating system. So, the operating system will take that decision whether we are going to follow a first-in, first-out scheduling algorithm. That is, whoever comes first will get the CPU first. Or a shortest job first. That is, whichever's execution time will be minimum, will offer the CPU to that process first. So whether we are going to follow this strategy or any of the other strategies that are available, so that decision is going to be taken in the service of the operating system. So now let us look at the third service. That is memory management system. We have in our computer memory, someone needs to keep track how much memory is there left in the computer system, how much memory the OS has captured, how much, suppose we have a new process that has been created, how much memory is going to be allotted to this process, from where that memory will start, from where that memory will end. So all these are being taken care of by the memory management system. Also, when a process is created, memory needs to be allotted. Similarly, when this process has been terminated, so memory needs to be deallocated. That is, here it also keeps track of the free spaces that are available in the computer. So when we need to allot a space to the program, it will allocate from here. And when this program has been terminated, again this space will be kept track of by the free space management that is part of the memory management system. Now let us look at the fourth subsystem service. That is file management. Now we have already talking about file management, that here we are going to take care of how the file is created, how a file is deleted, opening of a file, reading of a file, renaming of a file, copying of a file. So all these functions will come under file management. Next, let us look at another service, that is input-output management service. Now, input-output management service will take care of the different devices that are connected with a computer. For example, a printer, a keyboard, a mouse. So, when we give a particular input to the computer, that will be taken care of by the input management service. Next, let's look at some other services that have been offered. So, the next is networking system. So networking systems gives us services like remote login and remote copy. Okay, those are the services of the networking system. Next, another service is user interface. That is how we try to connect, how we try to give commands to the computer. So it can be done using a terminal, it can be done using a mouse, it can be done using a keyboard. So all of these different types of features will come under user interface services. Next, the last one is protection. That is, suppose I have a multi-user computer system. So, some of those files I want to be shared and some of those I don't want to be shared. So now, suppose another user comes and tries to access a file that does not have the shared option. So, that user should not be able to access my unshared document. So now that will come under this protection service of the OS, that any user that doesn't have access to a file, then he should not be able to use it or read it or access it. So that comes under the protection service of the operating system. So we have completed till here. Do you have any doubts till here?
No ma'am, thank you.
Okay, so then we'll quickly go to the third segment. So the third segment is about a different types of classification of operating system. So now this operating system classification has been done on based on the purpose on which these operating systems were developed and the functions that they support now. Okay, so let us look at the back at the history. So in what happened in 1940s? So in 1940s, there were no operating systems, but what we had were something like a console which has 8 or 16 toggle switches. Okay, so this could only accept machine instructions. Now along with this 8 or 16 toggle switches, we also had buttons for restart, shutdown, debug. So all these options were also available in these electronic computers at the time of 1940s. So whatever instructions we wanted to give could be given using machine instructions. Now next, let us look at what happened in the 1950s. So in the 1950s, we had something that is known as punch card system. So in this system, what happened was the programs were written in punch card and they were being read by a punch card reader. So this era had assemblers and high level languages. Those were written in these punch cards. So now what happened here was every user could get a time slot for a particular day and he could come with his punch card and he could run his program. But now for every user, the compiler have to be loaded first, then his program will be executed, and if there was an error, then his punch card would be halted and his program would not be executed. Plus the remaining slot of the time that was given to that user would be wasted. So this kind of system was very costly and it was very time consuming. So because of these defects, we come to the first operating system, that is the batch operating system. Now in batch operating system, what was done is we had a resident monitor, which could be said to be the first operating system that is developed. So this resident monitor took files from different users and it could automatically execute these files and give results. So suppose suppose the second user had a file which had an error in it, then it will simply go on to the third file. Now there, the instructions for the resident monitor were given using something known as JCL or job control languages. So this job control languages, in here we've specified which job we wanted to do first and in what way we wanted the job to be done. So these instructions were given using JCL or job control languages. So this was the basis for our first operating system, that is batch operating system. Now the next operating system is multi-programming operating system. Now all the jobs that we give the computer system to perform, they can be divided into either CPU instructions or input-output instructions. So if you really think about all the jobs or the programs that we offer, that we give the computer to perform, they can be either divided into CPU instructions, that is either they are processing type of instructions or they are input-output instructions. Suppose for example, if I write a simple C program, suppose main, simple C program, so main, so I take three variables A, B and C, then I take a user input for variable A, similarly user input for variable B. Now let us put the summation of A and B in variable C, and then again let us display this variable C. So simply, so this is a simple C program. So now we can see that this instruction, this part of the instructions are CPU instruction, these two are IO instructions, Again, this is a CPU instruction and this is again a IO instruction. So all the jobs or the programs can be divided into these two categories. Now, the user input instructions are very, as we know, the user input is slow because we human beings are very slow when we compare us to a CPU or a processor. So these instructions will take more time as compared to this instruction. The CPU instructions are being operated or being processed by the CPU, while these input-output instructions are going to be operated by a special part of the CPU, that is I/O operator. So now, this will take more time and the CPU instructions will take less time. So while the I/O input are busy, we can offer the CPU to some other programs. So this is the concept behind multi-programming OS, that while the input-output part is slowly working on one program, we can offer the CPU processor to another program so that we can work on two or multiple programs at the same time. Now let us look at the fourth type of operating system, that is time sharing operating system. Now in the batch operating system and in multi-programming operating system, we do not have any real-time interactions with the user or with multiple users. Now the time sharing operating system gives us this feature that we can communicate with multiple users at the same time. Now how do we communicate with multiple users at the same time? What we can do is, suppose we take 1 second and this 1 second can be divided into multiple milliseconds. So suppose for example we have 4 users, user 1, user 2, user 3 and user 4. So when we have multiple users and we need to respond these 4 users at the same time, what we can do is divide this 1 second into 4 parts and give one part, suppose 100 milliseconds to the first user, the second 100 milliseconds of this 1 second to the second user, the third 100 milliseconds to the third user and again to the fourth user. And once we have given the 100 milliseconds each to the each users, again we can give the fifth 100 milliseconds again to the first user, and this way we can continue. Now as a user, I will not be able to recognize 100 milliseconds. I can only, as a human, we can only recognize till 1 second. So when the computer gives me 100 millisecond time of a second, I will not be able to distinguish. For me, I will realize that the computer has been in respond to me for the whole time. So that is the idea behind this time shared operating system. Now let us look at another operating system, that is personal computer or personal OS. So this is one of the most common operating systems that are available nowadays. So basically personal operating systems are one user only operating systems. Okay, so the next operating system is parallel operating systems. Now the concept behind parallel operating system is such. Now we know that a CPU has a fixed speed limit. So the CPU can only reach a particular high of speed limit. So once it's reached its highest speed, it cannot go any further. But suppose we need the work done more faster, then what we can do is we can allot more than one CPUs for a particular computer. So there can be 2 or more CPUs per computer. So that is the concept behind parallel operating system. That is, any job that we need to do done more faster, we can divide it into 2 parts if that is allowed, and then we can give one part to one CPU and the second part to the other CPU, and we will get the job done more faster. Next, let us look at another operating system, that is distributed operating systems. Now, distributed operating systems are basically a connection of large number of computers that are connected through high-speed internet networks. And very good example of distributed operating system is our ATMs that we have in our banking system. So, distributed operating system basically, it will give us the feel of a single user operating system like a personal computer, but actually it has a large number of computers. And the CPU work can be divided between all of these computers. Next, last operating system that we are going to discuss here today is real-time operating system. Now, real-time, as the name itself suggests, means that this operating system has to give results within real-time. That is, a time limit will be given for the execution of jobs in this operating system. So, and if the time limit is not maintained, then a catastrophic or some hard measures need to be taken. The real-time operating system has two parts or two different types. One is the hard real-time operating system and other is the soft real-time operating system. Now, in hard real-time operating system, if the operating system doesn't give the results within that particular frame of time that has been mentioned earlier, then it leads to a catastrophe. But in soft real-time, it can be relaxed a bit. For example, of a hard real-time software, we can see about rockets or air traffic control. If we give a particular instruction and that instruction is not followed, then it will lead to catastrophe. For example, suppose India sends a rocket to the moon, okay, and we need to change the trajectory or otherwise it will crash to an asteroid. So in that case, what we do is we need to give a real-time instruction to the rocket to change its trajectory. Only then we can come out of that catastrophe. So that is an example of a hard real-time operating system. Whereas, for example, of a soft real-time operating system, it can be something as a weather sensor. Okay, so if the weather sensor, instead of taking the weather sensor at suppose 20 hours, instead of taking it, it has taken them 20.05 hours. So there won't be any catastrophe. Okay, so this kind of example is for soft real-time operating system. So these were the different types of operating system classification that we have learned today. Let me give you a summary of what we have taught today. So, first of all, we have defined operating system, followed by the three objectives that each operating system need to have. After that, we have defined the different type of operating system services that any operating system needs to provide. After that, we have looked at the different type of operating system classifications. So now, this ends the first chapter, that is introduction to operating system, which is a very basic level chapter. So in the next chapter, we'll learn about process. So we'll learn about processes and along with it we'll also learn about threats. So we'll learn about the process, what is a process, what is a process control block, what are the different life cycles in a process, what is a thread, what is multi-threading, different types of threads. So all this concept we are going to talk about in the next class. So thank you for listening to me today. Thank you.